Hello everyone, welcome to lecture 7 of CRPC. I am Priti Dhairya, and in today's lecture we would be covering the topic of search, seizure, production of materials. I hope till now whatever we have covered in the last 6 lectures is clear to you and you are able to establish the link that why are we proceeding in such a manner. So now before we start on with today's topic, let's try and understand that why was the need to incorporate such provisions under the code. Now in the previous class, you saw that you dealt with the arrest of a person. You are arresting a person so that you can bring him to the court. There in the court, when he'll be examined, he'll tell his version. You'll contradict it with the version that is coming from the opposite side or the prosecution side. And then you will try to come to a conclusion. But would that be enough in a criminal trial? Obviously not. There would be other materials that also need to be examined. For example, if it is a murder case and you are trying to pinpoint the motive towards a particular land dispute between the two parties, then you will try and look for the very documents, etc., that are showing that yes, there actually existed a land dispute where because of greed somebody had encroached or somebody had grabbed somebody's land, all of that. So you need to find that particular document also. Then only you can put a name that yes, this is the motive by which this murder was done. Or for example, if a murder was done and you have to find, you are trying to establish that this was an injury was caused by, for example, a blunt object, etc., that led to death, then you'll try to find out that particular thing. So all these particular things, obviously the court cannot remain silent on that. How will you go and look for those things? How will you seize those things? How will they be produced in court? All of that is there over here, and that is what we'll be doing in today's class. So let's start off with first, that is section 1. So here what we are seeing, that if any court or an officer or in charge of a police station feels that they require a document or any other thing, for what purpose? For investigation, inquiry, trial, or any other proceeding under this code, by or before such of court or officer, what will they do in that case? The court may issue a summons, or the police officer will put out a written order. Court is issuing a summons and the police officer is putting out a written order. To whom? To the person who has a possession over the same or who has a power over it. Look, please come and attend and produce that particular thing, or just produce it at such and such time and place. Now, if this particular person, instead of coming to you personally and giving it to you, just sends that particular thing, so just produces that required thing, that would also be enough for compliance. And this particular section 91 does not affect section 123, 124 of Evidence Act or the Bankers Books Act, letters, postcards, etc., which are in the custody of the postal or the telegraph authority. Now, this particular section 91 cannot be taken to apply to an accused, as it would be contrary to Article 20 Clause 3 of the Constitution. What is Article 20 Clause 3? The protection against self-incrimination. You cannot send a summons to the accused that, look, you have this particular document, come and produce it before me. Or look, or officer cannot send a written order asking the accused that you have a particular document, come and give it to me, because that would amount to self-incrimination. Okay, when we were seeing, if you remember the examination part, if you remember the previous classes where we were dealing with the examination part of a medical examination, etc., where you're taking swabs and all of that from a person, that was not held to be a part which is being affected by Article 23. I hope you can correlate that. And then Section 139 Evidence Act is telling you what? That just by producing a particular document doesn't mean that the person has now become a witness in that particular case. However, if there is an omission to follow the summons, the court has issued a summons that, look, please bring such and such document which we know is in your possession or you have the power over it, and you do not do so, it becomes an offence under Section 175 of IPC. I hope it is clear. The Article 20 Clause 3 part is also clear. Please go back to the arrest lecture and you'll find out where we had dealt with the part that the physical examination or the medical examination of a person which is leading to a particular evidence. For example, if it's a rape case and the DNA samples except that have been taken out from the prosecutor's body, etc., which are matching with the accused, that cannot be taken as one example of self-incrimination. That doesn't get hit by Article 20 Clause 3. However, if a summons is issued here, that can be hit by Article 20 Clause 3. Now let's see section 92. 91, if you can see, you remember that 91 is not applying to letters, etc. in the custody of postal or telegraph authority. 92 is dealing with the exact that thing, that what if that particular object, document or a thing is in custody of a postal or a telegraph authority. Here, see the difference. There was a court or an officer. Here, it has been defined who are the authorities who will do that. If the district magistrate or the chief judicial magistrate or the high court or the sessions court is of the opinion that that particular object, document or thing which is lying in the custody of a postal or a telegraph authority is required for investigation, inquiry, trial or other proceeding, such magistrate or such court may require that authority, that postal or telegraph authority, to cause such delivery to a specified person. So only these four authorities will tell that they feel that it is necessary. So they'll say that you, postal or telegraph authority, please cause such deliveries to a specified person who I'm telling you. And any other magistrate apart from these four, that is any other magistrate, whether executive or judicial or the commissioner of police or the deputy superintendent of police, if they want such an object, document or thing, they will require the authority to cause a search and detain that subject to the order given under the above subsection. So any other magistrate, commissioner of police or DSP also have to take an order from that particular person for causing a search and for detaining that thing. They'll require that particular DM, CGM or High Court or the Sessions will give an order that, okay, you can go for it. Then they'll send an order that we have taken the prior permission and now we are asking you. They're asking the postal and the telegraph officer, please search for this particular thing and detain it. Understood? Now let's move on to search warrants, that is section 93. Now section 93 is saying that the court has a reason to believe that the person who was summoned or who has to be summoned under section 91 or for whom a requisition was sent under section 92 first will not produce, or it is not known that who has the possession, or the court feels that for an inquiry, trial or any other proceeding under the court, a general search warrant will suffice, then it may issue a search warrant and the persons to whom the warrant is directed will search according to the provisions. Now court feels that it needs to specify which place the search has to be conducted or which part of the place has to be conducted, they can also do so. And the moment a specific mention is given that you will search only the left side of the house or the right east side of the house, etc., you can only search that part. And this does not authorize any magistrate other than a DM or a CJM to grant a search warrant in respect of things which are coming under the authority of the postal or the telegraph authority. And if it is a general search warrant, in execution it is found that the accused has possession over the same, it will be valid. This is a difference between a general search and a specific search. The inspection here is why this is allowed. This will not be hit by Article 20, Clause 3, because here the inspection was for a locality, not especially for the documents. You were given for a search that, okay, it may be found in a particular area. There you went, you feel that the accused is carrying that particular document, you searched and found from him, that would not amount to self-incrimination. I hope you can understand the difference under Section 93 search and Section 91 search. I hope that is clear. And general search can only be for the purpose of inquiry, trial or other proceeding under the courts, while for specific search, that is for specific documents or specific things, that can be for any purpose, that is that you can use it for investigation also. Now on this point you have to see that what we had done in the first class, where we covered the definition section of section 2G inquiry, 2H investigation, that you can see here what is the difference between inquiry, what is the difference between investigation, you can correlate and understand the difference. This was section 93. I hope you could appreciate why we are distinguishing between section 91 and 93. Now sections 94 to 98, you can go through them. I have not dealt here because I felt that much you can start off, you'll be able to understand better if you go through them on their own. They are like for a specific situation. For example, 97 is telling you for search of persons who are wrongfully detained, etc., who will issue the warrant. So see for what purpose that section is giving, what purpose that section is encapsulating for, and who is the issuing authority and what powers do they have. In this sense, you can cover sections 94 to 98. Now, there's one very important case law on this part, MP Sharma versus Satish Chandra. I'm just giving you the name of the case law. If you want, I can discuss it later also. We can see that in the end, not now. I first want to complete at least a Bare Act portion and a little bit of extra information before we move on to the case laws. But this is an important case law. You can do it on your own. Let's now see Section 99. What is Section 99? Section 38. 70, 72, 74, 77, 78, and 79 also applies to the search warrants which are issued under Section 93, 94, 95, and 97. So these sections are applicable to the searches under 93, 94, 95, and 97. And what are that? Section 38 deals with the aiding of an officer. 70 and 72 deals with the form of a warrant, etc. 74 is what happens when it is directed to another officer. 77, as you can remember, executed any other place. 78 and 79 are the procedures which are prescribed when it goes outside the jurisdiction. Now let's see what is under Section 100. It's an important section because sort of it's giving you the procedural aspect of this particular search. So if a place which has to be searched or inspected, for that matter, is closed, then any person who is residing there or is in charge of looking after the place, on demand of the person who is executing the warrant, if the person is demanding, and after seeing the warrant, he wants to see the warrant that okay, then he has to allow that person to ingress, that he has to allow the person to get inside, and he has to allow him all reasonable facilities for search. For example, if he goes inside, there's another lock lying on another door, he asks for it, he has to open it. And if he is not able to do so, then he'll go according to Section 47, Clause 2. He'll go back to arrest, you'll see what are the powers over there. Then, if it is suspected, for example, that any person there is concealing the article of search, for example, the search was for a particular piece of a document, etc., and you have a suspicion by search, the officer gets a suspicion that somebody here is concealing it, then that person can also be searched. That is, the physical body of that person can also be searched in such a search where you actually had come for searching a particular locality, but you came under the suspicion that that person might be concealing that article. That is why you are searching him too. And again, here, remember, very logical step. If it's a woman, you'll conduct that search by a woman, and there'll be strict regard to decency. But same thing, I'll repeat to you, as I said in CPC, CRPC is also a very, if you can apply a little bit of logic, you'll be able to understand why such provisions have been made. Procedural laws are not made to complicate things, it is just to put down a process. Little bit of understanding, and that you'll be able to sort of even guess what should the next step be. You might have to remember the days and all of that, but you can understand. Like, obviously, if it is a search, then there will be provisions that if the house is closed, what will happen? If there is somebody, if somebody is hiding it, then what will happen? This is what is there. Now, what do you see under Section 100 before we digress a little more? Let's go back to the topic, that is, here what happens: before conducting the search, the officer or the person, whoever is conducting it, will call two or more independent and respectable inhabitants of that very locality or any other locality, if nobody is coming from there, to become a witness. You are ensuring that there are independent people to ensure that it is an impartial search. It is not that this person is going and planting something there, all of that. You are calling them for what purpose? Please attend and become a witness. And for this, they can also issue an order in writing that you have to come to do so. Like, they are not coming, nobody is ready to come. The officer or the person who has come for the search can issue an order in writing that you are required to come here and be here and attend as a witness. And the search has to be made in their presence. Whatever the seizures are being made, the list has to be drawn up, where they were found, which officer found it, and the witnesses have to sign this. However, just because they were witness to the search proceeding does not mean that they have to be required to attend court also. Like, they become a witness or they're required to attend court unless and until the court specifically summons for them. And the occupant, whoever has given you the permission to search the house, he is also allowed to be there in the there. And this particular list that was drawn up with the witness's sign will also be given to him. Now, if a person was searched, for example, if you remember, I was having a suspicion, for example, I went for a search, I was having a suspicion this particular person might be concealing the document I'm looking for. I searched that person. I just searched that person and I'll leave it haywire there. Maybe I found the document, didn't find the document, whatever happened. Whatever happened after that, I'll draw up a list, and whatever I have seized from him, whatever I'm taking away from him, I have to make a copy, again signed by the witnesses, etc., and give it one copy to him. And again, here you'll see, if you have been called as a witness, but you're not coming even after being called and after giving an order in writing, it becomes an offense under section 187 of IPC. Then what are we seeing under section 101? First, before 101, I hope 100 is clear to you. 100, what did we see? 100, we saw if it is a closed place that you can ask for getting in. If you feel somebody is concealing, you can search the person also. Then calling of witnesses is necessary, and the drawing up of list, signing by the witnesses and giving it to him, etc. Now let's move on to section 101. If there is an execution of a search warrant required outside the court's jurisdiction, then the things found with the list of the things seized will be immediately taken back to the court which had issued that search warrant, unless such court is nearer to the court which actually has jurisdiction over the case. Then that magistrate who has jurisdiction will authorize by order that, look, okay, you can go take it to the court which had issued the warrant. I hope that is clear. Then what is section 102? This is a power of a police officer to seize what? Which is a property which is alleged or has been suspected to be stolen, or is found under a circumstance that creates a suspicion that there must be have been a commission of offense in relation to it, that it is a stolen property or it is an extorted property, etc. And if that officer who is seizing it is a subordinate to the officer in charge of a police station, he'll go and report to the officer in charge of the police station. And soon after that seizure is done, you have to report the same to the magistrate who has jurisdiction over the matter. And where you are not able to transport that particular property conveniently to the court, or there's a difficulty in searching a particular proper accommodation or a place where you can keep it in safe custody, etc., continued retention of that particular property in police custody is not required for investigation, then they may give it to the person to whoever it belongs on a bond that he'll produce it before the court when and as and when required. And proviso is saying what? That if it is subject to speedy decay or the person is unknown, absent, and the value of that particular thing is less than ₹500, then you can sell it under the auction under the superintendent to police orders, and sections 457 and 458 have to be complied. Here you are seeing the police is seizing a property with they have some suspicion, etc., and soon after, like a stolen property, etc., for example, vehicles were stolen, you found a lorry. Now it's not easy to transport a lorry to the magistrate. So what they can do is that they'll just report it to the person, or they'll be giving a bond to the person that you have to produce as whenever and as and when it is required, and that. So, and again, there may be properties which are subject to natural decay, speedy decay, etc., and if it is less than 500, then sale can be done, auction sale can be done. Under whose orders? The SP, and 457 and 458 have to be complied with. And the next section that we will see is section 103, where any magistrate also has the power to direct a search to be made in his presence of any place where he is competent to issue a search warrant. So a magistrate has also been given search powers, and that can be made in his presence, and that should be such a place where he could be competent to issue a search warrant. And under section 104, any court, if it thinks fit, may impound any document or thing to be produced before it under this code. And what do we mean by impound? Impound is taking into legal custody, etc. I hope that is clear. Lastly, in respect of foreign territories, I'm not dealing in detail over here. You can see section 105 regarding the reciprocal arrangements regarding processes, 166A and B, letters of request for investigation, etc. And search without warrant is a situation, and the provisions relating to search without warrant, sections 165 and 166, that we'll be dealing when we'll be starting off with the investigation, that is in the next class. I hope today's class is clear. There is no problem with it. In case there is any problem, or you need more clarification on a particular section, or you want me to discuss a case law, this we'll keep for the end. If there's time left, we can discuss case laws. Please let me know. I hope that is clear. And from next class, we will start from investigation. and I hope there's no errors with the content and there's no audio issues, etc. So see you soon in the next class. Thank you and bye bye.